Since the beginning of ancient civilization, man has recorded visitations by beings from other worlds. In the lands of ancient Egypt, great structures known as the pyramids were erected. Why? Some say they were tombs for ancient kings, yet no mummified remains have ever been found there. Perhaps they were built in honor of alien travelers and served as a sort of marker to denote where they could land. Or maybe they were built by the aliens themselves and served as great housing structures. The low passageways and small chambers within the pyramids would suggest a smaller sized occupant. Could they be for small, otherworldly inhabitants? Hieroglyphics inscribed in ancient tablets and columns describe the visits by these intergalactic travelers. They also describe the return of these visitors and tell of the year that they will come back. Scientists have translated this as being the year 2011. Figures carved in stone show fantastic creatures who are not of this earth, and indeed are inscribed as being gods from the heavens who descended upon this planet. In the Bible, many angelic visitations can be interpreted as visits from extraterrestrials. Angels, beings who fly through the sky and have an ethereal glow about them, sound very much like descriptions of modern-day encounters with aliens in shiny metallic clothing. In the 20th century, visions of angels have given way to visions of metallic saucer-shaped aircraft. The painter's canvas has become the photographer's lens, capturing hundreds of photos of the UFOs. Comic books of the 1930s also depict their versions of the flying saucers. Elaborate, fanciful, full-color artwork has helped to stimulate the reader's imagination and open them up to the possibility of UFOs being real. During the 1940s, especially during World War II, Air Force pilots continuously reported seeing strange lights and saucer-shaped objects in the sky while flying on their seemingly endless missions into enemy territory. The government kept these stories quiet. After the war, sightings continued to occur with regularity, but escaped public interest until one particular story broke in the summer of 1947.
Headline edition, July 8, 1947. The Army Air Forces has announced that a flying disc has been found and is now in the possession of the Army. Army officers say the missile, found sometime last week, has been inspected at Roswell, New Mexico, and sent to Wright Field, Ohio, for further inspection.
The wreckage was collected and taken to Roswell Army Airfield. The military immediately issued a cover-up story stating that the wreckage was from a weather balloon. The story was issued to every major publication, and photos of the wreckage were released to further support the story. But the civilians who found the wreckage told a different story. They saw wreckage that included chunks of metal with hieroglyphics on it, and some claimed to have seen the bodies of four aliens, one of which was still alive. The story sparked the imagination of people around the world. Hollywood immediately jumped on the bandwagon, and the result was a popular string of alien invasion films during the 1950s.
Gee whiz!
Invaders from Mars, capturing humans at will for their own sinister purposes, turning them into diabolical instruments of destruction. Invaders from Mars. We're fantastic beings of a super intelligence, ruling a race of synthetic humans.
Flying saucers have invaded our planet. Washington, London, Paris, Moscow are key targets. The whole world is under attack. Can it survive?
Disintegrated solar system. At this moment, the remainder of our fleet is circling your globe.
Never before has the screen reached such heights of excitement, breathtaking spectacle, hair-raising terror. See the saucer men's high-frequency disintegrators. See great cities leveled by flying saucer monsters.
To give you these facts. But if you threaten to extend your violence, this earth of yours will be reduced to a burned out cinder.
I saw it, I shot at it, I hit it, I know it. Nothing happened, it just kept coming at me, making a noise like a gun. Captain, it was awful. You could have seen those hands and those eyes. Captain, you've got to do something about it. You've got
to. Is it human or inhuman? Earthly or unearthly?
See?
What happened, Doctor?
In the greenhouse, I was working. I couldn't see.
Yeah.
Then a blast of cold air, and I heard Olson scream.
Come here. Get in the corner. Now hold this in front of you. Stay by the light switch.
1.9. Needles hit the top.
Eventually, man became the space traveler in spacecraft of his own design. Rocket Ship XM was the first film with this popular theme and starred a young Lloyd Bridges.
90 degree turn completed.
Reduce power.
Thrill as you get a moon's eye view of Earth. Streak through a barrage of hidden dangers.
Meteorites!
It is just 1 minute before takeoff time in the uninhabited desert of White Sands, New Mexico.
Tell them to stand by for count off and firing.
59. 58. 57.
But 56. To reach this dramatic moment, were months of construction, checking every detail 1,000 times, and a desperate struggle to convince the skeptical, to outwit those who would stop us, to muster up courage to challenge the black, airless void of terror-stricken space.
3, 2, fire!
I didn't want to come.
You can blame me, Joe.
I could have blown my brains out or gone over Niagara Falls in a barrel or found some other decent way to die.
High on a mountaintop, an army of scientists worked desperately to build this giant rocket, this modern Noah's Ark to carry a few picked survivors of our doomed civilization to a new life on another world, reaching the heights of self-sacrifice, the depths of the animal lust for survival as they fight to be among the few who can be saved.
Let's take the ship away from them! Come on!
Fighting among themselves, fighting against time, as doomsday is upon them.
I think all you scientists are crackpots.
Nothing is going to happen.
Eventually, man traveled in the flying saucers themselves, albeit as captive abductees.
They're pulling us up.
Prisoners hurtling through endless space, speeding toward the unearthly furies of a planet gone mad. See sights never before dreamed by man. the battle between guided meteors and deadly rays.
They're gonna hit us! They're gonna hit us!
A planet doomed to destruction.
Run, Ruth, run!
But the most popular reoccurring theme that has remained the most successful throughout the years was that of the Earth being invaded by otherworldly enemies.
This could be the beginning of the end for the human race. For what men first thought were meteors or the often ridiculed flying saucers are in reality the flaming vanguard of the invasion from Mars.
Looks like they're going to come out of that gully pretty soon. We'll have to rush our defenses to be ready when they do.
Guy can need plenty of reinforcements.
We'll get them. Lieutenant! Look!
They slash across country like scythes, wiping out everything that's trying to get away from them.
That explains why communication is cut the moment their machines begin moving.
Montreal's blacked out. Nothing more's come through.
Same thing that happened on the Pacific coast. Anything from them yet?
No, Mr. Secretary. We've had nothing from San Francisco for over 5 hours.
The nations of the world mobilize their armed might, rushing to defend the Earth against the unknown weapons of the super race from the red planet. Is there nothing that can stop the Martian death machines?
Guns, tanks, bombs. They're like toys against them.
We know now that we can't beat their machines. We've got to beat them.
All over the world, human beings cower before the onslaught of these unearthly enemies, whom no one has ever seen. Panic that sweeps around the globe as the great masses of mankind flee blindly in a headlong stampede of hysteria.
War of the Worlds remains a classic example of invasion paranoia. This science fiction theme continued to thrive well through the 1960s in slightly grimmer films and on into the 1970s.
You!
Sometime in the near future, when we least expect it, they will come. Cities will burn. Mankind will panic. Our world will tremble. When the invasion from another time and another place begins, disbelief will be shattered, and the truth of an ancient past will be revealed. When it occurs, you will see men turned killers by mysterious power. Women will be defiled by the invaders from outer space.
It's Barbara. She's the one.
It could happen in your lifetime. See it before it's too late.
They come from above, below, and beyond. They come with answers to the unknown, power from the stars, and horror from the depth of a million mutant minds. They communicate with time and wage an interplanetary war for eternity. We know they are there. Why have they come? Starship Invasions, rated PG.
Much stranger than any fictionalized movie are the seemingly endless accounts of UFO sightings over the years, simply due to the fact that they supposedly actually happened. The big UFO craze started in the early part of 1947 when the whole nation was being buzzed by aircraft that didn't appear or move like any planes they knew. On June 24, 1947, pilot Kenneth Arnold was in the air looking for a downed marine transport plane near Mount Rainier, Washington, when he spotted 9 boomerang shapes in flying formation. He described their movement as like a saucer would if you skipped it across the surface of water. A newspaper man printed this expression as a flying saucer, which coined the phrase that still is used today to describe UFOs. Less than 1 month later, the nation was sent into a UFO feeding frenzy when an object similar to that described by Arnold was found crashed in the New Mexico desert near Roswell. Sometime during the evening of July 2nd, almost obscured by rain and thunder, a crash occurred. A different sounding crash, something like an explosion. As foreman of a working sheep ranch, it was Mac Brazel's job to inspect the ranch the following morning to check for rain and lightning damage. He came upon a field strewn with metallic foil-like debris, covering an area approximately 3/4 of a mile long and several hundred yards wide. As Mac examined the debris, mixed in with the foil-like metal were small, plastic-looking I-beam pieces, light in weight like balsa wood. He also found heavy parchment-like paper. On some pieces of debris, Mac Brazel noticed what looked like Egyptian hieroglyphic-like writing in columns. Unable to find a crater or impact site, he gathered up some pieces of the debris and continued his inspection of the ranch. Upon the urging of family and friends, Mac Brazel decided to take a sample of the debris to the county sheriff. After looking at the unusual fragments, George Wilcox, sheriff of Chavez County, called Roswell Army Airfield. Roswell was the home of the 509th Bomb Group, the sole unit in the Army Air Force equipped to deliver atomic weapons. It was the 509th that dropped the atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. If there was something unusual going on in the area, Roswell Field would know about it. Intelligence officer Major Jesse Marcel drove over to the sheriff's office to take a look at the debris. Puzzled by the unusual nature of the fragments, he contacted his commanding officer, Colonel William Butch Blanchard. Major Marcel was told to get someone from the Counterintelligence Corps, drive to the debris site, gather as much material as they could, and load it into two vehicles, and report back to Roswell. Major Marcel contacted Captain Sheridan Cav Cabot, and they spent the rest of the day driving to the Foster Ranch. That afternoon, military police confiscated the debris fragments Mac Brazel left at the sheriff's office. It is presumed they were flown to 8th Army Air Force Headquarters in Fort Worth, Texas, and from there to Washington, D.C. By evening, Major Marcel and Captain Cabot had arrived at Foster Ranch. Too late to gather debris, they spent the night in sleeping bags at a small shed on the property. The next morning, July 8th, Mac Brazel took the two men to the debris-strewn field. Once there, they loaded their vehicles with debris fragments and headed back to Roswell. The saucer the debris came from was found 150 miles away, crashed into a hillside. A family rock hunting in the area found the craft as well as four aliens. Three of them were lying on the ground, and the fourth was seated beside them. Their bodies were small in size with large hairless heads. Two of the aliens appeared to be dead. The family was soon joined by some archaeology students who had been working nearby. They attempted, without success, to communicate with the aliens in various languages. Before long, U.S. Army troops arrived. Without explanation, they quickly ushered the curious onlookers away from the crash and back to their cars. The area was then immediately sealed off. At around 12 noon, Lieutenant Walter Hout, Roswell Army Airfield Public Information Officer, walked into local radio station KGFL and dropped off a press release for the radio station to send to the United Press Bureau Wire Service. The press release stated simply that the Army had recovered the remains of a crashed flying disc near Roswell, New Mexico. Soon, phone calls were streaming into the radio station, and suddenly Roswell was famous. Within hours, however, the Army officially contradicted itself. At 8th Air Force Headquarters in Fort Worth, General Roger Ramey, head of the 8th Air Force, and his chief of staff, Colonel Thomas DuBose, held a press conference. They stated that the wreckage was really from a weather balloon's crashed radar reflector. The wreckage presented at the press conference, however, did not match the debris fragments collected by Mac Brazel or Major Marcel. Those who would be entrusted with this sensitive information had to be trusted to keep quiet. Midwestern and Pacific Afternoon newspapers carried Lieutenant Hout's original story, but the following morning, the New York Times and Washington Post carried only the weather balloon story. The press conference had effectively killed the UFO story. Most of the people associated with the events of July 1947 have passed away. It is the children and grandchildren of these people who have come forward to corroborate their family members' participation in what has become known as the Roswell Incident. Each individual story contains a piece of a puzzle that tends to confirm an official long-standing policy to cover up the existence of UFOs and extraterrestrial contact. Sightings of UFOs and their inhabitants, little green men, continued at a high rate after the Roswell incident sparked everyone's interest into watching the skies, despite the attempts of the government to invalidate the reports. Many people who saw the chance vote, V-173, affectionately called the Flying Flapjack by the Air Force, mistakenly took it for a flying saucer with good reason. Others saw cigar-shaped craft, like Eastern Airlines pilots Childs and Whitted. At 2:45 a.m. on July 24, 1948, the pilots came upon a very bright light dead ahead. They banked their DC-3 plane sharp to the left to avoid a collision, and the UFO passed within 700 feet of them. As it flew by, the pilots noted that it was about 100 feet long, shaped like a cigar, and was belching red fire from its tail. It had two rows of windows that were large and square. From inside the windows came a bright light, and the underside of it glowed a bright blue. It had no wings or fins, but had an antenna-like pole protruding from the tip. A passenger who happened to be awake at the time saw it too, and confirmed the pilot's story. As a result of the numerous sightings, the Army Air Corps decided to investigate the possibility that these UFOs might be enemy craft. Project Sign was initiated in 1948 with Captain Edward Rupert in charge. Project Sign became Project Grudge and finally Project Blue Book in 1952, when it was upgraded after the rash of sightings of UFOs nationwide, culminating in the famous sightings on two successive weekends over Washington, D.C. in July of 1952. On July 19th and 20th, between 11:40 p.m. and 3 a.m., radar operators spotted apparent UFO targets on their screens. At first, the objects moved at relatively slow speeds, but were then observed to fly away at fantastic speeds. Many people on the ground saw the lights in the sky, sometimes over the restricted air lanes over the White House and the Capitol building. When Air Force jets arrived on the scene, the UFOs had gone. The next day, UFO stories were all over the capital city. The following weekend at 10:30 p.m. on July 26th, radar operators picked up UFO activity once again. This time, Air Force jets were immediately scrambled into action, and all passenger planes approaching Washington were turned away. The jet pilots encountered lights in the sky, and when they tried to overtake them to get a closer look, the object zoomed away at terrific speed. The jets finally gave up after running low on fuel and returned to the Air Force base. The case, witnessed by the pilots, citizens on the ground, and radar technicians, was initially denied by the government, but later classified as an encounter with unknown foreign aircraft. Another facet of UFO study is their possible link to the mysterious disappearances in the Bermuda Triangle. A triangulated area off the coast of Florida, the Triangle has claimed numerous ships, private sailing vessels, commercial airliners, military aircraft, and thousands of lives since the times of Christopher Columbus. The mystery of the Mary Celeste and her vanished crew was spawned from within the Triangle. The steamship Cyclops encountered a thick, gritty fog within the Triangle before it vanished without a trace. The British airliner Star Tiger was on a routine flight from the Azores to Bermuda in 1947. No wreckage nor any of its approximately 75 passengers were ever found after it disappeared in the Triangle. It remains a mystery that will never be solved. But perhaps the most famous disappearance within the Bermuda Triangle occurred on December 4, 1945. Training Flight 19, consisting of five Grumman Avenger torpedo bombers, took off from Fort Lauderdale Naval Air Base in Florida at 2 p.m. Their routine flight took them east into the Atlantic, then north, then southwest back to the base, a small triangular patrol within the much larger, sinister Bermuda Triangle. The flight was progressing normally and was typically uneventful until it was time for them to radio in for landing instructions. But instead of asking for instructions, the tower at Fort Lauderdale Naval Air Station received transmissions from Flight 19 that they were lost. They could not see land, they were unsure of their position, their compasses all malfunctioned, and they could not figure out which way was west. They claimed that the sky and the ocean looked wrong, repeated the message that they were lost, and then disappeared. Shortly after the panic transmissions ended, the Naval Air Station at Banana River dispatched a Martin Mariner flying boat to try and locate and rescue the supposedly downed flight. After scouting for Flight 19 for only 20 minutes, the Mariner 2 disappeared. A massive search consisting of submarines, aircraft, Coast Guard cutters, every available vessel was launched. 280,000 square miles were scoured in the Gulf of Mexico and the Atlantic. No survivors and no wreckage was ever found. Do these vanishing planes and ships merely crash and sink so quickly that there's no chance to find them? Or are they abducted by a much larger craft from another world for study? That seems to be the popular explanation, since UFO activity has been reported in that area. If that is so, why do so many vehicles continue to disappear even to this day? What would extraterrestrials do with the hundreds of air and water craft and their thousands of passengers? Only time will tell. The 1960s saw its share of UFO sightings, and 1967 in particular was a boom year of sorts, with more photos taken in that year than any other. On January 9th, two brothers in Lake St. Clair, Michigan, were relaxing in their backyard when a UFO appeared. It was moving slowly at a low altitude and remained in view for about 10 minutes. The brothers grabbed their Polaroid camera and took these pictures. On June 1st, hundreds of people saw this UFO over San Jose de Valderas near Madrid, Spain. The markings on the bottom are extremely rare in photos, yet have been reported numerous times by eyewitnesses. The saucer looks extremely similar to that photographed on June 28th by Gabriel Cazora in Newcastle, Pennsylvania, half a world away. In Ontario, Canada, on September 29th, this photo was taken. Although Project Blue Book proclaimed it as a possible fake, it bears a striking resemblance to the object photographed earlier in the year in Lake St. Clair, Michigan. The two different photographers had no connection between them or any knowledge of each other. Astronauts, too, have seen UFOs while orbiting the Earth on their journeys through space. The first definite sighting was on June 4, 1965, when the Gemini 4 flight team, James McDivitt and Edward White, were orbiting the Earth on the first American two-man spaceflight. They were on their 20th revolution around the Earth when they saw a strange object with projections sticking out of it coming straight for them. Just as they were about to take evasive action to avoid a collision, they lost the object in the sun, and it vanished. During the flight, they took movie footage of the craft, and two of the frames were released to newspapers. Air Force officials immediately claimed that it was the Pegasus satellite, but that claim was thrown out when it was proven that the Pegasus satellite was 1,200 miles away at that time. Public opinion declared that it was an authentic extraterrestrial spacecraft. 2 months later, on August 2nd, citizens from the Mexican border all the way up to the Dakotas saw an object similar to the craft seen by McDivitt and White. This photo was taken by a 14-year-old boy in Tulsa, Oklahoma, of mysterious lights. The astronauts of Gemini 7 also had a similar experience when they did their time in orbit.
Gemini 7, here, Houston 98.
Loud and clear. 7, go ahead.
Approach you at 10 o'clock high.
This is Houston. Say again, 7.
So we have approach you at 10 o'clock high.
Roger.
Gemini Control here again. The reference in that conversation was bogey. It was Borman who reported sighting the bogey. This is Gemini Control in Houston at 4 hours, 24 minutes into the flight.
Bogey is the military slang for an unidentified flying object, and to see one in space would almost be too hard to believe, but it does happen. The most exciting of all UFO sightings in space happened on July 19th, 1969.
We got an intercept.
Roger, we confirm, Sturzep.
The crew of the Apollo 11 were on their way to the moon for the first lunar landing and were one day into the mission when they saw a strange object between them and the moon. They initially thought it was the Saturn IV booster rocket, but were informed by mission control that the rocket was 6,000 miles away. Neil Armstrong remarked that the object looked like an open suitcase, and Michael Collins called the sighting really weird. The sighting is still classified as an unidentified flying object. The 1970s saw a rise in the sightings of alien creatures. This entity was seen in a garden in Belgium in 1973. Note how similar it appears to the entities that appeared to a man also in Belgium after his car stalled when happening across a landed UFO in 1970. In 1972, an Argentinian cowboy saw this creature inside a UFO as it hovered just above him. Also in Argentina in 1971, a driver saw these creatures walking down a road. He said their eyes were glowing. And in Alabama, a police chief took this photo of a humanoid creature that was standing in the middle of a highway. Photographic technology in the 1970s led to fewer photos with a higher quality, making it harder to disprove their validity. Taken with his simple 35mm camera, Billy Meyer's photographs are some of the most detailed and clear photographs ever taken. That the reason for the clarity of his photographs is that the occupants of the spacecraft have allowed him to take the photos to prove their existence to the world. Billy has told reporters that the occupants of the spacecraft have informed him that they are from the Pleiadian star system and have come to our Earth to study it and us. He says that the aliens will allow only him to photograph them, that they open up a field of vision directly to his camera. That you could be standing right next to him as he takes the photographs and you would see nothing, but he will still capture the image on film. In addition to his remarkable photographs, Meyer has been able to capture these incredible images on 8mm film. They are presented here for your examination. Thank you. Through the years, many other amateur photographers have also managed to capture images of UFOs on 8mm film. This film was taken on July 28, 1959. No ordinary explanation could be made to identify this mysterious object. In Great Falls, Montana, these two objects were photographed over a baseball stadium in late summer 1950. At Jackson Lake, Wyoming, on August 10, 1972, hundreds of vacationers saw this glowing orb streak through the sky. This UFO was photographed in the skies of England in January 1973. On April 15, 1966, a professional cameraman was able to capture this UFO over Catalina Island in California. UFO sightings continue to this day. It is estimated that one out of every 10 Americans has seen a UFO. Ask around. You may be surprised to find out how many people you know that have seen one.
About 3 in the morning, I was sitting out here smoking, relaxing, about ready to go to bed, and I noticed a light over here in the distance. Bright light. Thought it was probably a helicopter searching or an airplane, but it was standing still, it wasn't moving. And I watched it for a while in one place, and it just sort of hovered there. And then all of a sudden it moved vertically over a straight line, and I started to think, well, it is a helicopter because it's moving now. And I kept watching it because the light was a light I've never seen before, sort of pulsating. And all of a sudden it went straight up in the air, horizontally. It stopped and then went straight up. And stayed there for a little while, didn't move, and all of a sudden it was gone. Took off, flash of light, shooting star.
It happened kind of like late at night, about 10:30 or so. I was just going back to my brother's house, and I was in my van, and I had some car trouble, and I'm not really good mechanic, and my girlfriend isn't much one either. So we stopped for the night about over there somewhere, and you know, we're just gonna go ahead and sleep because it's so dark, there's no moon or anything, you know. So I don't have a cellular phone or anything like that, but so we stayed the night, and I don't really know, I think it was about 2 in the morning or so, it was still dark, and there's loud noise. I thought it was like a gunshot or something. I didn't know what to make of it, so I got up and I looked around, and out there beyond those rocks, I saw this it was so strange. It looked like a searchlight, just kind of probing the ground. But it was just kind of weird. I mean, I thought it might have been a helicopter, you know, but I didn't hear any noise, sort of speak. I just saw this light probing the ground, and I, you know, without that initial noise, I didn't know what to do. It was kind of strange. I just watched it slowly go around, and it went about a half a mile down that way, and it's just the weirdest thing. I mean, I was the only one up, so I couldn't wake up my girlfriend, and and the thing jumped up into the sky and was gone. And it was just so strange because, you know, then I woke her up after, but I didn't know what to make of it. So, I mean, it's just the weirdest thing, you know. I've never seen anything like that, and I don't know what to make of it, you know. But you know, we came out the next day, you know, me and my uncle came out the next day the next night, and kind of we decided to camp out because it was just such a strange deal. But we hung out. We didn't see it again. That was the last time I saw it. But it was just really, really weird.
In recent times, the mystery of the Roswell incident has surfaced once again, with the discovery of lost government documentation footage of an autopsy being conducted on what is believed to be an alien from the Roswell crash. The authenticity of this footage has been the subject of much debate and controversy. It is offered here for you to draw your own conclusions. Unidentified flying objects have been with us since the dawn of time. They have been chronicled by man throughout history. From ancient etchings to modern photographs, they have been documented and analyzed time and time again, yet no one can explain them. Perhaps one day they will be explained, but until that day comes, we must keep watching the skies.